Welcome back to the Scare Set Podcast. This is your host, Mike, and my co-host, Scott. How are you doing today, buddy?
I'm doing pretty good. Doing decent. It's middle of the day right now. I think we had a pretty decent day today.
Yeah, pretty solid day at work. I'm going to apologize in advance. I am getting over some kind of a cold or something, so I kind of sound like dog shit. And if I'm coughing during the episode, that's why.
Yeah, we both were pretty sick this past week, so.
Yeah.
Whatever happens, happens, but we're at the end of it. I think it's like the last few days, so. We sound a little bit hoarse, or we have to start smacking our throats. It is what it is.
We're not sick enough to have not gone and seen the 25th anniversary screening of Scream, though.
Did you feel like you were going to cough in the theaters, though, or get, like, or, like, be sniffly or shit?
Oh, I was, so.
Because I was very self-conscious about that.
I was trying to breathe through my mouth as much as possible, and I repeatedly put my finger on my nose because I was going to sneeze.
It's like people in behind you, they see you. like is he in labor? Like
no, I was just there like I did that I had to do that more than once because it was just too much, and I almost sneezed like 5 times. My eyes were watering throughout like most of the middle act of the movie. And I feel like someone could have turned to me and I was going like this, and they're going to be like, oh, man, it's not that good of a movie, you know?
Yeah.
I was just sitting there like, oh, my God, I look like I'm crying. And I'm like,
gross. Yeah, I met Ashley's, one of her friends from high school, and one of their boyfriend. And Ashley was like, oh, are you going to shake their hand? I was like, I don't really feel comfortable doing it because, like, I feel like I'm sick or whatever. Like, well, if you don't do it, I think you have, like, COVID or something. I'm like, well, I don't have COVID, but, you know, I still don't want to get somebody sick even knowing I don't have COVID. So the entire time there, like, I'm doing my best to, like, not cough, not, like, shoot, like, phlegm or anything. And I'm just like, how's it going? It is nice to meet you. And then my voice is like, it's nice to meet you, because there's, like, no power to it.
Yeah, like that whole day before I went, because my girlfriend had she left to go. I think she went to Six Flags, and I was talking to her the whole morning before, because I saw it at 3. You saw it later at night. You saw it like 7.
Yeah.
I was talking to her and I kept on like breaking up. My voice kept on falling apart, and she was just like, "Oh no!" She was skipping. I'd be like, "I was a fucking sick dog." Yeah.
It was a tough experience. When I was at the theater, I had taken enough medication where I don't think it was that bad, but the dinner before going to the theater, they both had to go to the bathroom, and the second they did, I took my napkin, I started shooting like as much snot in there as possible. I started pounding my chest, coughing, everything. I'm like, I have to get this all out. It was so tough. I felt like one of those people like in a TV show when they're trying to pretend they're somebody they're not.
Yeah,
that's how I felt that entire dinner. I was like, oh man, I'm so broken, but whatever.
Yeah, the whole screening, I was like holding everything back. I had to cough a couple times. I couldn't avoid it. One of them was because I inhaled a kernel of popcorn. No, I will totally admit that. But it triggered a coughing fit of the other variety, so it was what it was. But I tried to hold as much of it in. As soon as I got to my car, I ripped my mask off, and I was just like sniffling like crazy. And I think I sneezed violently. It's just like I held that the entire time. That was not fun.
Yeah.
I haven't been that sick in a while. It's been quite a while since I've been sick.
Yeah, well, you can tell Josh, but thanks for getting both of us sick.
Yeah, fucker.
But the movie that we're talking about that we had an unpleasant experience with is the movie Scream, which is what we're covering today on the podcast.
Well, the overall experience I had was actually really pleasant, but the sick part was not the best part.
Well, I'm not talking about the actual film, but just nobody wants to be the one being noisy in a theater.
Especially during a pandemic.
Yeah.
When you're sitting going...
Oh, that like, that's how I felt so bad about that in the restaurant, because I'm coughing. I'm like, people are going to think I have fucking COVID because I'm coughing.
That was my big thing, was I was sitting there, I'm like, someone's going to fucking go get an usher and they're going to kick me out. They're going to think, oh my God, this guy has COVID, he's going to spread it.
Like, I know I don't. Like, if you took my temperature, it would read that my temperature's not high, which is a prime thing that is usually connected to COVID. So I knew I was, it wasn't that, but I just didn't want people to get in their head and stare at me during my dinner. I would have taken my fucking burger and thrown it at them and said, like, I'll get you sick, dude, if you keep fucking looking at me.
Yeah. You saw it in a... We didn't see it together.
No.
How was your experience as far as the crowd was concerned?
There was only maybe two, three other groups of people there, and they all sat in a close proximity. Nobody was noisy. Nobody complained. I went there as a group of four with me, my girlfriend, my girlfriend's friend, and their significant other, and that was decent. So I had a good, enjoyable experience. I wasn't noisy in the theater, thankfully. It wasn't a huge crowd, but to be completely honest, there's not been many films I've seen in theaters lately that's been over 50 people.
Yeah, my crowd was pretty decently sized. I wouldn't say it was near 50 people, but it was pretty decent for, especially the size of the theater, because I saw it not like a stadium seating, like it was a pretty big theater. And there's a decent amount of people. We were all laughing, having a good time. None of us were being disruptive or anything, so we were all having a good time. Yeah, I mean, most of us had all seen the movie.
Laughs in mine as well.
Yeah, I did have someone next to me who, as the movie was over, I was telling you about this today. They took their girlfriend. Apparently, they drove quite a distance to see this, and their girlfriend had never seen the movie. And they're like, I drove you all the way over here to see this movie, and you know, this movie sucks, and you wanted to see it so badly, I drove you over here. And I'm like, why'd you come and see it? Why did you show this? Why'd you hype this up to your girlfriend and tell her to come see this with you if you know you don't like it?
I could do that.
It was kind of funny listening to them, though.
I would see a film I don't like in theaters if it's still a cool experience, though. Like, if they had the first Friday the 13th in theaters, I would watch that in theaters.
Yeah. I mean, there's a difference to, like, the way he was talking is just like, I hate this movie. And like hearing him talk about like the parts about it that he doesn't like is like, he definitely did not have fun watching this movie with us. And it's just like, okay. I mean, I can have a decent enough time watching Friday the 13th.
Well, I mean, as we're going to find out during this episode, I have my
problems
with this film, and I still sat down and watched it.
Yeah. Well, it was different. It sounded more like he had nothing good to say about the movie. So I was just like, why are you coming
to see this movie? I think it's a great film, but the things I'd have to speak about, it would come off like I really don't like the film.
Yeah.
Like, as we're going to discuss about this, like, it's a great movie. It is a great movie, but the script almost makes it not a great movie sometimes, and it really takes it away. Like, when I left the theater, I said, do I feel any differently about the film? No, I just feel stronger about the things I like and strong about the things I dislike.
Yeah, we previously in another episode discussed how you feel about Scream, especially because of how it changes the face of the 90s horror.
Yeah.
So,
for worse.
Don't have to bury the lead that much.
No, I mean...
We know you're not a big fan of meta-related things.
See, that's not true, though. Like, I think it's all about, like, how you handle situations. It's the same reason,
but 90s meta.
I'm just not a fan of 90s films.
Yeah, well, yeah. But 90s meta, there's a certain flavor to 90s meta, especially post-Scream.
So, this film is very synonymous with how it metatextually takes films from the 80s and addresses those cliches. Whereas Fright Night is a film from the 80s that metatextually explains cliches from mostly Hammer horror in that era.
Yeah.
And the way Fright Night handles its metatextual stuff, I genuinely love. But the way Scream handles it, I genuinely hate. But those two differences pretty much come down to the decades. Because Scream handles things in a way a dialogue could only be delivered in this time period. If Scream was written and made as a film nowadays, it wouldn't be discussing slashers, first of all, so I don't know why you'd do it, but it's just, it would be better written. I don't think Kevin Williamson's writing is bad. I think he's an adept writer. It's just that in this time period, he wrote a film that was made for the 90s, discussing metatextual stuff that the 90s would discuss it in that way, and that's why I can't stand it.
It's a very of-its-time movie.
Yes.
But I also love how of its time it is. I love the meta stuff in this. I don't like the wave that this movie created. I don't like a lot of the stuff that came after this.
Yeah.
But I think
that you can't hold it, this film, the same way you can't hold it to Saw, you can't hold it to Halloween.
Yeah, it's not like you can sit there and say Kevin Williams and you never should have wrote this good movie.
Yeah.
Because people after you were gonna trace the trend that you started. It's the same thing with Halloween.
Yeah.
Like the same thing with any trend setting horror movie. It's just like it's gonna be good, it's gonna be well received, it's gonna be financially successful, and then other people are gonna say, well, I wanna try to do that too, but they're not gonna be as good at it for the most part. And I don't like that stuff about it, but I think that as far as this kind of meta horror, I don't think in this era anybody touches how good this is.
In the 90s, no.
No, I wouldn't even say.
Getting
to stuff like Cabin in the Woods, which is definitely not directly connected to this, but definitely has the DNA of something like this. Like, this is way better than that, too. Like, I think that it comes down to the fact that it's directed by Wes Craven, who is a phenomenal director, who I think reigns in. This could have been a lot crazier than it even is. And I think that he, as a director, reigned in a lot of the crazier antics that we could have gotten.
And I think that's kind of my polarizing feelings on the film, because I think, like, it sounds rude to say, but if this film was on mute, I would like it more. Because, not because, like, characters are annoying. Like, I just don't like the way the dialogue flows and the narrative is about metatextual humor. But the way Craven directs the film, it's so strong. Like, his direction is really good. The way he sets up shots so you could pick up on things going around in the background or things following suit. Like, his direction is great. When he's just directing a horror film or just directing teenagers interacting, it's a really good directed film. I just don't like the dialogue in the film, which he did help Williamson with the screenplay. It wasn't just him. He did.
Yeah, of course.
He did assist in it. But when I had watched the film years ago, I did not realize there was this many references to movies in it. But this last watch from seeing it in theaters, I'm like, there has to be a fucking different movie named up every 5 to 10 minutes. And I felt like every single time, and it's like, this is a movie.
Mm-hmm.
But if these were real, there's no fucking way all of these kids, these teenagers that are 17, have seen all these fucking horror flicks. Like, there's no fucking way. And they're quoting it like nothing. It's like, oh yeah.
I still think that the bulk of the actual movie referencing, it does come down to mostly Randy. And he works in a video store. So.
But, like, I had thought that before the film. It's like, Randy does that. It's his character. But, like, they mention Dreaded Sundown. Randy's not the one that mentions that.
Yeah.
They continuously mention other films. Psycho gets mentioned multiple times by Billy. And, like, if Randy does it, Randy just talks about the rules. And you know, whatever. I hate the rules, but those rules establish things that are supposed to be cliches that this film goes out of its way to say it doesn't matter. This is an hour movie, which in a way narratively works for this movie, but in the same time it feels like it's saying, I'm so fucking smart and I don't like that.
I don't think that it is inconceivable that these people watch these movies considering that they're, what, 17?
Yeah.
In the 90s.
They're 17 at that point, in the 90s.
Especially stuff with like stuff like the Town of Dreaded Sundown and all these movies. Like, they're movies that, you know, they're still kind of in the consciousness because they're only about 15, you know, maybe 20 years old.
It boggles me because some of these characters talk like they don't like horror films, like the main character. Some of them seem like they don't think much about it, like when Rose McGowan's character says, oh, it's like a Wes Carpenter flick, which that line is supposed
to... It's an in-universe joke.
And yes, obviously, but that line is supposed to say, like, she doesn't really follow these films.
Well, no, the whole
point
is that...
the fucking directors actually are.
No, the whole point is that there's a director named Wes Carpenter, because they can't have, there's no Wes Craven or John Carpenter.
Well, there has to be a John Carpenter.
Well, yeah, there's Halloween.
Yeah, Halloween gets referenced a lot in the movie.
But they're not going to have Wes Carpenter.
Also, because... they have Wes Craven gets mentioned because they mentioned Nightmare on Elm Street too.
They mentioned Nightmare on Elm Street, but it's kind of like in Halloween 3, where it's just like these movies kind of just exist in the universe. But they're not like...
I mean, they have to know those... I take it as she just fucked up two people and misremembered the names because she doesn't know the movies that well.
Probably.
I think that's the way it's supposed to be taken, because she's the quote-unquote archetypal bimbo blonde.
Yeah.
And she's not supposed to be all that knowledgeable. But she's also name-dropping a ton of these films. Like, it's just weird. I don't know.
She doesn't name-drop that many. She name-dropped
Sundown. I've seen that film, or I've seen that as well, or whatever.
Yeah, she doesn't sit there and make continuous references to them. Again, like, this is a movie that came out during the VHS generation. This stuff all, to me, all that makes sense. None of them are as eccentric about it as Randy is. Because Randy has no life and works in a video store. Like, they're casual references, and these are things that not me and you, but things that people in our generation do about movies from our generation or our more recent past. I don't think that is really that ridiculous. Is it annoying at times? Yes. Yes, it is.
Oh, it's annoying.
Particularly, I think the stuff with, like, we talked about it today at work, we all go a little mad sometimes, makes me roll my eyes every time.
Yeah, the line itself
wouldn't make me roll my eyes nearly as much if he didn't say, Norman Bates Psycho, like we did already
and
know
then,
that.
And then, again, quote Psycho right after that about saying, did Norman Bates have a motive? Like,
yeah.
Dude, shut the fuck up.
Yeah, I mean, I guess the whole point, though, is that he thinks that life is a movie. I mean, he even says it to Sidney himself, and he's so wrapped up in justifying what he's doing based upon the movies he has seen. And him even saying that the reason why we know what to do, they say horror movies don't make killers, they make killers smarter. And it's like, these are people who are fucking nuts, who... Yeah, you know, I don't find all that to be that crazy, but the one thing where he feels the need to explain that it's by Norman Bates in Psycho, that makes me roll my eyes every time. That one always gets me. Just like, that's unnecessary.
I think it just comes down to, like, when it's adding up. Like, if it's like, same with American Werewolf. American Werewolf has references to Lon Chaney's Wolfman. There's only two or three in the entire film.
Yeah.
And it's referencing a wolf film, which makes sense. You know, it exists in the universe. But it never feels like it's being mentioned every time they talk about a wolf, you know? It's not shoved down your throat. So, like, that's why I like those mentions, and I think it's cool to have name drops in that film versus The Howling, where it feels like every 5 to 10 minutes, something is wolf-related. There's another fucking wolf pun. They talk about wolf this, werewolf that. A werewolf movie's on the TV. This guy had a book by Jack Wolf or whatever.
Yeah.
When things are being too constant in your face, it feels like this metatextual stuff is taking you out of the narrative of the film. And that's why it's tough for me to feel like I'm having fun with this film, and then I have another fucking thing thrown at me. Like, I love the ending when Stu and Billy are talking to Sydney, but when they keep bringing up movies in it, I'm like, can we just keep this being about her fucking mom? Like, stop talking about movies for 5 fucking minutes. Like, I know I'm watching a movie, I get it. I know these guys watch a lot of fucking movies and they're crazy, I get it. Just keep it about the fucking mom. Like, all the time it's No, don't blame the movies on this. It's like, dude, just some of this dialogue, just rip it right the fuck out, fast forward it, get to the cool shit, please. Because it's so well directed. Like, it's so well acted. I think Skeet Ulrich does a great job as Billy. I think Wes Craven does a good job with the direction of these characters and everything's going well. It's just the dialogue really just takes me out of it because it's just so referential and it's so annoying to me personally.
Yeah, I feel like this movie would be completely gutted if you did that.
I would just tone it down if people would not enjoy it that much, that, you know, whatever. I have a hard time enjoying this film with it being so referential. It would be a stronger film if I didn't feel like it was the annoying kid on the bus who's trying to tell me, no, I definitely like comic books. These are the three I own, and I know everything about these characters, and they keep telling me about this shit over and over again. Like, dude, I don't fucking care. Like, this movie is that annoying kid on the bus to me, where it's like, I why are you trying to talk to me about this? Like, I just don't talk to me.
To me, this is Kevin Williamson and Wes Craven venting frustration over the way that Hollywood and critics have viewed horror movies for decades. And the whole point of all the references is to build to the crescendo where we get to the whole the rules thing, and they buck every single one of them. I think that's the point of the whole thing. That's just how I read into it, and that's why it doesn't bother me. It's because they're just venting their frustration.
I would understand that if it just didn't come off so in your face.
That's like, just the 90s.
It's not an excuse. But
that's just the 90s.
I'm yeah, like... It's the same way. It's like the 80s can be cheesy. It's like it's just the 80s, or like the 70s can take things a little too seriously sometimes. So, you know, I understand why these films come out in these decades and why you have to put it in perspective. Like I know this film functions so much like a film that came out in its decade, and I get that. And that's why I can let it kind of slide from a majority of it. But it seems like every time I'm just like, whatever, man, it's just of its time. Then another thing hits me again. It's like, I already fucking let it slide, dude. Stop fucking bugging me. And then it's like, all right, I'll let him go again. And then he hits me again. It's like, you keep fucking punching me, dude. I'm gonna get mad.
Yeah, I mean, it's a matter of personal preference.
Oh yeah, how much is too much per person? You know.
Yeah. So
I can't say it's a bad movie. Like, it'd be easy for me to sit here and say like, I think Scream sucks. It's badly made. The fucking story doesn't hold up. But I can't do that. It's just one of those cases where like, this is a really good movie. It's a lot of fun, and I like the killers. I like the final girl. I like all the characters for the most part. They're at least, if they're not well developed, they're at least fun. It's just the dialogue really just takes me out of it, and that's the only real issue. And it comes off like constant bitching, like, well, you seem like it's a big issue. It is a big issue, but like, if this film was gonna be like a 9.5 out of 10, it'd still be a 7 out of 10 or a 7.5 out of 10. It's still a great fucking movie for me. It's just, if some of those things were toned down, it'd be easier to digest, is all it is.
Yeah, I get that. Yeah, I mean, 95% of the references don't really bother me, but there are a couple that do. Just like, okay, cool. I mean, whatever. We're gonna go there today. You know, some of them are a little like, I find some of them funny, but when I think about them in retrospect, I'm like, that's kind of dumb.
Yeah.
You know, like the scene where Randy's on the couch drinking and watching Halloween, and he's yelling at the TV, you know, look behind you, look behind you, look behind you. And Ghostface is behind him and all that stuff. And it's just like, okay. Yep. Yeah, okay. It does lead to, you know, the whole 30-second delay camera thing is cool.
I yeah. like that.
That stuff's cool.
Almost all the stuff I think if he, horror is very good.
I think if he said, look behind you like three times less, it wouldn't be a problem. But it's just like, he keeps saying, I know he's drunk, but like,
yeah.
You could have trimmed that a little bit. I like, there's a lot of very, very smart things about this movie, from just like, divorcing ourselves from the meta part for a minute.
Yeah.
Just like pure direction, pacing, and yeah, I mean, like the entire first sequence, which, you know, now is been parodied to death in movies, even within the Scream franchise. If you just take that scene on its own as a short movie, it is insanely well made.
Yeah.
And it's kind of funny because I've been listening to the Taking Shape book, which is about the making of the Halloween franchise. And obviously Kevin Williamson went from this, which was super duper successful, over and did work on Halloween H2O. He did a uncredited rewrite of dialogue, I believe. but also the editor of this movie, Patrick Lussier, went over there too. And he was discussing how the first time when they turned in the dailies for the opening sequence, the Weinsteins lost their mind and said, you don't know how to direct, Wes Craven. You're terrible. What the fuck is this movie that you're making? And then they had Patrick Lussier come in and re-edit this movie, and it completely changed the scope of how the sequence works. And it really does nail home how important editing can be and how it can really change a scene and how it plays for people. Funnily enough, Patrick Lussier would go on to have a pretty strong career in horror. You know, he directed like the My Bloody Valentine remake and a couple of other really big horror films. So he learned at the feet of the master, Wes Craven, so it's pretty cool. But from frame one to the credit, and it's like a 10-minute sequence, I think, if not maybe a little bit longer.
I don't think it's longer than 10 minutes.
It feels like it's it's 10 minutes.
I think it runs pretty well-paced.
Yeah, I feel like it's probably about 10 minutes. But they do the whole... I used to think that they try to bait and switch you and make you think that Drew Barrymore is the main character. I mean, they kind of try to with her on the poster.
I think they do.
But in the movie, they don't really.
They only do because of the build before the... Like, in the film, they don't, but...
Yeah.
But when on my screening, I watched it. I got there like 30 minutes early. They showed the trailer. She's in the trailer more than Sydney.
Yeah. Like, the marketing is all about that. Like, people compare it to the way that they handle it in Psycho, where it's completely different.
Yeah.
Like, she really is treated as the main character for half of the movie. No, not half of the movie. Like, 25 minutes of the movie. And here, it's more so like everyone went into the movie expecting Drew Barrymore to be the main character. And then as soon as you get to, do you like scary movies? It's instantly like, oh, she's toast.
It's more comparable to Tina, if anything.
Yeah. And that's fine. Yeah. Because as soon as you hear the voice on the other line, on the other side of the phone, it's instant unease. Because something's wrong. Something's just wrong about the voice. And I can't remember the name of the voice actor who plays the voice of Ghostface, but
it's Jackson. I think it's Roger Jackson.
He is so good. He is so fucking good. But I always go through that sequence. It is always heart in your throat. And Barrymore's great.
Roger L. Jackson.
Yeah, he's. I mean, he does it for all four. I'm sure he's probably doing it for five. But it is consistently, you know, Wes Craven building and building and building and building and building until they hit a crescendo. Every time I see the opening of this movie, it never fails to not just make me very tense, but actually emotionally move me towards the end, especially. The performances by the parents, don't remember the actors' names, but they're barely in the movie, but they are so believable in the reaction that they feel hearing Barrymore's character dying on the phone and then finding her body. It is so raw. It's not like a lot of the stuff that's in the movie.
No, it's a very different tone.
It's a harsh opening.
I'd almost say, like, I like Matthew Lillard a lot in the movie, but his character is never serious. Absolutely never.
Yeah, no.
Not one scene is he ever depicted where he's being straight fit. I would almost like it. I mean, the shit he says at the end is so fucking funny.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
I love that shit. It's so good. I would almost like it better if when he was just playing fun or having a good time when he's in front of people, and when he's revealed to be a killer, he was actually, like, calculated, slow, stern. Like, that'd be cool.
It does really demonstrate. I think that Matthew Lillard toes a very specific line in the movie where he is being very big with his performance, towards the end especially.
It's very intentional.
Yeah, it's a very big performance, but I would say he rides this line between being really funny and also being completely deranged. Like, especially because of the way that he views this whole situation to begin with. it's like a game. More so than Billy. Like, Billy's taking this like, this is like a, you know, I am crazy and I am going to murder everybody. But he has like a genuine like anger to him. Whereas Stu is just like, if this never happened, kind of just following Billy around.
I always look at him as like the type of person that he's clearly very popular, very cool. People the like doofus. Him. But like at the same time, it's like the rush. Like what's the biggest high? Like,
yeah.
Like, and he feels like he can get away with it is the thing. Like he can just feel he's on top of the world.
He's not registering the. I feel like he just doesn't register the seriousness of what's going on.
Yeah.
Obviously, there's two killers.
Yeah.
So, he does kill at least somebody. But it seems like he doesn't. He disassociates the seriousness of that because he thinks that this is fun.
Clearly, this isn't even gonna try to be preventative for spoilers. We're gonna. Be very
spoiled. We never do, so.
We have been for the last two. We've been trying our best.
Yeah, I mean, for
not Exorcist, the last two, the ones that are come out next, right?
Yeah, I was gonna say The Exorcist, we definitely were not very conscious of
spoilers. Yeah. There are three kills, I'd say, in the film. Really. There's
Casey at the beginning.
No, there's four. There's four.
Her boyfriend.
So Casey, principal. The boyfriend, the principal, the girlfriend, Tatum, and then
Billy and Stu,
the fucking camera guy.
Camera guy, Billy and Stu.
Yeah, I'm not counting them. If you're counting them, people who get killed by the killer.
Yeah. Okay.
So there's five. Yes.
Yes. Yes. So principal was a reshoot.
So there's five. Who do you think kills who?
Oh, I have no fucking clue.
I don't know. Just. Try to think about it with the way the film builds. I don't believe Stu kills his girlfriend.
Yeah, Billy kills Stu. Because Billy's not at the party yet.
What?
Well, Billy's not at the party yet when Tatum dies.
Yeah.
Billy's she hasn't shown up yet. Billy, yeah, Billy definitely kills her.
Yeah.
It's kind of funny because they're not like the same height. So you'd feel like you'd be able to kind of tell. Because Matthew Lillard's not a short guy.
No, he's fucking 6'6".
Fucking tall. So he's like
tall as shit.
You think you'd be able to tell? I think that they genuinely use the same stunt man for all the kills, so you didn't know who it was. So they cheat a little bit. Because I don't remember him being very tall. I remember him being pretty average height. I don't remember him being like really tall. Because, like, you'd know instantly if you saw... He's the only fucking person in the movie who's even close to that tall. Yeah. So, like, if you ever saw Ghostface looking like he's 6'6", you know instantly it's Stu.
Well, I would think that because it's such a loose costume, maybe he kneels.
Maybe. I don't know. But it would seem like it would be something that they would have to cheat around because of Matthew Lillard's height.
Yeah.
Because he's just too tall.
I think it's insinuated that most of the kills are done by Billy.
I think most of them are by Billy as well. Yeah. I think if anything, maybe Stu kills the principal. Like more innocuous things. Things that are not super serious.
You think the final chase with Sydney is with Billy?
Mm.
With the camera guy getting killed?
I wouldn't be surprised if it's both of them. Because he does kind of pop up around. But then Billy has to be upstairs to come back downstairs as well. So I think that once they go outside...
Wait, no, it has to be Stu doing the chase.
Some of it, though.
No,
some
because he's still upstairs. Yeah, he's still upstairs.
Yeah, but with all the things that are going on, he can get back inside and go back upstairs.
I think that'd be very convoluted to make that work.
I don't know. Because then Stu appears out of nowhere too, and then Billy appears.
That's the whole point, is that
you know,
Randy says that he is the killer, so yeah. I would assume Randy saw him get out of costume.
Maybe, or Randy's also, you know, he's saying, well, there's two of us out here, and she's gonna think at least one of us is the killer. So maybe. I'm gonna say it's definitely Stu. I'm throwing Stu under the bus, especially after the video store scene where Stu was kind of like goading him on, and then Billy came up to him and was
intimidating. Yeah, I don't understand why Randy fucking, because Sue is a fucking asshole to Randy the entire time.
Yeah.
He's just a fucking dick. It's really, he should not be his friend.
That's why, like, Randy would definitely throw Stu under the bus instantly, because they're not friends, really.
No.
They all hang out together. It's kind of funny. Like, Randy is, like, the outlier. Like,
he's just there.
Yeah.
He's so more inconsequential to this film than I remember.
It's more so, like, Sydney likes Randy. Like, is friends with Randy. Out of everybody, like, she's easily the nicest person. But, yeah, like, Stu especially, and Billy, like, they bully him. They straight up bully him.
Yeah.
Granted, he does definitely very loudly in the video store scene just say Billy's the killer.
Yeah.
So, yeah. If he Billy was like a
killer.
Is that the face of a killer or what? It's like, yeah. That's kind of the thing. When I watched this movie for the first time when I was like 15, I was like, when Billy gets stabbed, I'm like, "Oh man, so he wasn't the killer." Because there's still doubt at that point. So I'm like, oh, he wasn't the killer, so it's somebody else. It's like Stu or Randy or something. It's going to be something crazy like that. And watching it now, I don't know how anybody could think it's not Billy. I'll walk this back a little bit. I can see someone saying they're laying it on so thick that he must be a red herring.
Yeah.
I can see that. Maybe it's because, again, like, I know he's the killer. Like, it just plays like he's just like, he's not hiding this very well.
Yeah.
I think, actually, if you take out a couple key lines, I think it's better. Like, when he's talking to her and in the school, like, at the stairwell, and she's saying, like, yeah, no, I don't believe it was you, blah, 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 blah. They found this, or this. And he's like, see, it couldn't have been me. It's just like, now you're overcompensating. She already said she doesn't think it's you.
Yeah. So
that feels like you're like trying to cover your ass, but what you're really doing is exposing your ass more. So if you take stuff like that out, and he does it more than once, and then also he gaslights the shit out of her in this movie.
Yeah.
Especially about her mother and him, her not feeling comfortable having sex and all that stuff. Like, it's just like, he's clearly not a great person. So.
Yeah, but they've been in a relationship for a long time, it seems like.
Yeah, but it's
played
it's
out to be, like, years, and, like, he's... I don't know. That's a very real conversation that you could have with somebody.
I think,
and
it's
like,
a
he's
very
frustrated,
real,
so...
I think it's a very real conversation to have. I do think that the manner in which it is... whatever, they're teenagers. Maybe I can see it happening that way, but I cannot imagine having that conversation with someone and telling someone to get over the fact that their mother died. Like, I can't imagine that.
No, but, like, at the same time...
I get being frustrated.
Like,
I understand
yeah.
that part.
It's just, it comes off rude in the dialogue, but, like, it's supposed to be rude. I feel like he's an asshole, but he's an understand. Like, it comes from a place of understanding. That's why she talks to Tatum being like, well, I get where he's coming from.
Like, yeah. I mean, I also, I get that, but
I think the dialogue between the relationship stuff is actually pretty good. For a 90s film especially.
I think some of it's good. I just think that, like, when you, especially because it's in the same scene as the whole, like, see, it couldn't have been me. It's just like, it doesn't make him look better. And to me, it does not help shift blame off of him.
Like, well, he also was in prison.
Yeah, of course.
I mean, say I wasn't a serial killer. My girlfriend had presumably put me in prison because she assumed I was a serial killer. And at the same time, we are not having sex. We've been together for a few years. I will also be like, yeah, I'm not a killer, and you won't fuck me. I don't get what the point of this is. Like,
I get the frustration aspect to it.
I don't know if I'd be
that.
More frustrated than spending a night in jail, and I'd be like, you know what? Maybe I will tell her that her fucking mom is dead and get over it. I went to jail! Like,
yeah, I get the frustration aspect, but... I think that, again, the whole, like, not just the whole, like, oh, see, it couldn't have been me, but also the way it's delivered.
It's the delivery. I will, like, 100% say the delivery is,
like, they're if you're taking out of the equation, these are actors, and these are people we're a fly on the wall watching. Like, I feel like it's very difficult to find that guy to be a good person.
I think the entire film, Wes Craven directed Skeet Ulrich to be very on the nose with the way he's talking to her. because it always seems like he's just lying.
Yeah, and I think that's kind of the thing. Is like, again, it circles back to the fact that, like, I feel like it's very easy to determine that he's the killer. I think the real twist isn't that he's the killer. Not even that. Well, yeah, that's a twist too. But I think that the bigger twist about the killer's identity is that there's two of them.
Yes.
I think that's the bigger twist. And it's kind of like the whole thing, like in Mission Impossible Fallout, where, like, it's not, you know, that this person's a bad guy, but it's that everyone knows that he's a bad guy.
Yeah.
It's the misdirecting of what the real reveal is. It's just like it does really feel sometimes like they're kind of laying it on a little thick. Like it feels like it's who the fuck else is it gonna be? Like, oh, is it gonna be the dad? Gonna be the dad. Like, there's no development to that idea deliberately. Yeah. Deliberately, it's not developed because it's not something that anybody takes seriously, other than the dipshit police chief. But you know, like it's one of those things where it's like there's not a lot of options, and this guy is acting sinister most of the movie. You know, there's some stuff where he, you know, very like, I like their first scene together. Yeah, you know, I think that they're very good in that scene together. I think they have good chemistry, but. As an adult, and again, like, this is also coming from a perspective of someone who knows he's the killer, it just feels super duper obvious while I was watching the movie in the theater. I'm just like, I don't know how I could have possibly thought that it was not him.
See, my biggest revelation this time in the film is that I thought Skeet Ulrich was supposed to be playing, like, a bad boy. Like,
yeah,
like from Breakfast Club, like Bender, like, clearly an asshole. But he's not. Like, this dude is, like, frustrated, but he's, like, understanding. He's like, no, like, I don't want to break your rule. I understand what you're saying. It's like...
He's a rich boy's son.
Like, I thought he was supposed to be a fucking, like, dick.
Yeah.
Like, he's supposed to be like, I don't give two fucks. The way he's dressed is like a fucking, like, 50s greaser with his hair back. Like, he's supposed to be a bad boy. And when I'm watching the film, like, you're really understanding about things, and you're very... communicative for someone who's supposed to be the dick right now.
It's kind of funny, he's only really dressed like that in the poster, really. Like, he's not wearing like leather jackets and stuff like that. Like, he's wearing,
I just mean like
most of the time he's wearing,
he has like rolled up sleeves in the intro too.
He's got like the
shirt at the end.
Yeah, I just think like he's got this blue polo on. He looks like a prep boy. He looks like a preppy boy.
I think only that one scene he's a preppy boy. The other scenes he looks like he's supposed to be like just kicking it back.
I don't think with his button down, he looks like he's particularly to be a bad boy, but
I think he's supposed to be playing a bad boy, but
it just
doesn't. The dialogue
I don't think he's supposed to be.
Like, Tatum goes like, he's too perfect. I'm like, I thought he's supposed to be a dick. How is he perfect?
That's what I mean though. Is like, I don't think he's supposed to be a bad boy in the movie.
I think they did a bad job structuring his character. Like, he clearly has like, with the way he's portraying the character. Like, he's supposed to be, like, the rough kid in school. The way he, like, has his head down, has his hair slicked back, he looks at people, like... These are mannerisms that I associate with the bad boy in town. But he's supposed to be, like, what's up, guys? How's it going?
Yeah.
I don't get that vibe at all from him.
Yeah, I don't really... Outside of, like, a couple of shots, I never really got the vibe that he was a bad boy.
I think it's just the mannerisms of the way Skeet Ulrich plays his character.
I also think like Skeet Ulrich just kind of has that look.
He does have that look, 100%.
Like, he just kind of looks like that.
He does.
So it's like it's one of those things where it's just like I think he's just gonna be that guy.
I don't know. I always picture him as being like the bad boy character. When I'm watching the film, like, they don't want him to be a bad boy, but he comes across like he's supposed to be.
Yeah.
Like, the movie wants you to think, like, he's a good kid who just gets put in the wrong place and then ends up being a killer. But I don't picture that when I'm watching this movie. He's not being... Yep. He's not acting like that. Skeet Ulrich is not portraying that type of character.
Yeah, I feel like maybe it's more of a situation of... That's the kind of... The way that the school probably views him, but in reality, behind closed doors... He's like a sweet boyfriend who does actually like respect Sydney to a degree.
He respects her.
Yeah.
As like his facade respects her.
Yeah, I was gonna say, because it's like at the end of the day, like, he has a plan.
Yeah,
like, he has a plan. Yeah.
his whole point is that, like, he's manipulative.
Yeah. And, like, she has to suffer for her mother's sins. But, you know, I think that his motive is strong. Like, his actual motive. Once you get past the meta shit about how do I need a motive, his actual motive makes sense.
I don't know. It's such a weird... Like, when he's angry, he looks angry. Like, he feels angry. Like, he's mad at people. And the performance just comes across like a different type of character than I feel like they wanted. I just think it's weird. The script does not back up who this person's supposed to be portraying.
Yeah. I think like with people like Randy, he's a tough guy. It's kind of gross. He's being super duper nice to Sydney or whatever.
Yeah.
Because he wants to get in her pants, which is gross, but yeah.
Well, he wants to do it more so because of the movies.
Yeah. He wants, because like, again,
I genuinely think that he doesn't really care about having sex with her, but just wants to get rid of her virginity to make her eligible to die in his mindset.
Yeah, again, like, it's all about his cracked mindset as far as what life really is.
Yeah.
You know, he even tells her, she says, you know, like, my life's not a movie, and he's like, yes, it is. You just don't get to pick your genre. And she's like, okay, so what's your genre? What's her genre? Tragedy, I guess.
His fucking genre is a fucking psychotic thriller.
Yeah, so it's like, he does literally... It's even at the beginning of the movie, like their first scene together, where he's saying, you know, like, we had a relationship, it was a hot and heavy, you know, R-rated relationship heading on its way to an NC-17. And also, he's like, then it feels like I'm kind of edited for... We're kind of edited for television.
I hate that,
like,
line.
Okay. Like, it just sows the seeds for the idea, like, he just does not understand that life is not my movie.
That dialogue, I had forgotten about that, so you just mentioned it. That shit was so annoying.
I find the part where he says, you know, I was watching The Exorcist on TV, and it kind of got me thinking about you, and she's like, it did. That shit's funny.
It's just... The dialogue in the opening with Drew Barrymore's character, where they talk about scary movies and shit, like, that fucking dialogue is perfect. It functions perfectly. It has a narrative flow to it. The dialogue pushes one scene to the next. And has a big crescendo to the finale of it. Like you said, it's almost a short film in that intro. And then you take more referential horror dialogue to being like, fucking NC-17, no, it's edited for TV. I'm like, I'm gonna walk in this movie and beat the fuck out of you, dude. Like, who the fuck says that shit?
Yeah, I mean, it didn't at all bother me, but I understand why it would bother you. To wrap it back around, like, it does just reinforce the way that Billy apparently views existence. Apparently, it's just like, hey, it's a movie. And she's like, that's kind of, you know, it's just part of him being fucking absolutely out of his mind. But
the thing I like the most about referencing how they had a relationship before the murder.
Yeah. So they've been together for at least a year.
Yeah. I also like the fact that they reference that because he's been playing this long game because he commits the murder of her mother.
Yeah.
So I just think making it so much more calculated and thought out is kind of neat for his character.
Yeah, I agree.
It's fucked up.
Yeah,
but it works. I like. Yeah, he has a strong motive.
And I think his motive is very not. I won't say it's sound, but I understand. It's a motive that you understand that someone would do something like this because of that.
I also like when they talk about the motive. Stu didn't know that.
Yeah, because you can see Stu be like, "What?"
Yeah, he's like, "Oh fuck, he's really crazy."
Again, like Stu doesn't take this seriously.
Well, that's like for psychology, when there's most cases of killers, there is one who's a dominant personality, and then one who just listens and
this is very accurate to that.
Yeah, and that's why I like it. Like, it would be cooler if Stu did flip a switch and he was more calculated, more like common demeanor, but the way that this plays out is more actually true to how events would be.
Yeah, it's very clear that, like, Stu doesn't take any of this seriously, but once the motive is brought out into view, Stu's just like, wait a second, what? But then again, like Stu is, yeah, they say, like, Stu knows that this happened. Like, he knows why her mother's dead. Because he talks about how it's been, like, oh, it's 1 year.
Yeah.
They both talk about how it's been 1 year. So it's like, he, again, like, he completely disassociates the seriousness of the situation, and that's why he's so just off the walls. And, like, yeah, like you were talking about earlier, like, Matthew Lillard in this, he is genuinely a treat in this movie.
Oh, he's so
funny. I fucking love Matthew Lillard.
I wouldn't say he's funnier than he's ever been before, but some of his lines are so fucking funny.
Oh, my God.
Like, the final shit where he, like, like, you hit me with the phone, dick.
Yeah.
That's so good. Like, are you really gonna call the police?
Yeah, you bet your fucking ass I did. My mom's so mad at me. So fucking funny. And it's like, it's in the middle of a nearly hour-long finale that just, again, like the opening, builds and builds and builds and builds until it ends.
I like to think that that line was improv'd.
Yes.
And, like, they were going to film more to the segment, but he says that shit, and Wes Craven just goes, oh, fuck, I need a second. Like, hold on, that was really yeah. good.
Yeah, Matthew Lillard's so damn funny in this. And, like, I remember also, like, because he gets really, really big in that kitchen scene. And he's where he's to the point where he's fucking spitting, and he has like a giant puddle of spittle comes down his fucking chin, and he's still going, he's still performing. It's like, that's, he's out of his mind in this movie, and I love it.
I'd also like to say that, like, even if you try to pick apart the way that these characters interacted in the beginning of the film, he has never once taken the serious nature about people being killed, the death of Sydney's mother. All of these things he's never taken seriously or really considered. So yeah. It's very in character for him to be one of the killers at the end and be like, well, I'd never fucking give a shit.
Yeah, like from the beginning.
That's why he's always joked about it. It doesn't matter.
He's telling Tatum how, like, you know, a woman can't kill someone like that. You know, can't, you know, gut a woman like that.
Yeah.
Because only men can do that. Which is like, okay. And then they start talking about it. It's like, You slit them from here to here, and you take out the guts or whatever, you hollow them out, and then even you know, crazy ass Billy's over here saying, you know, okay, dude, let's rein it in a little bit. Probably because Stu's probably the one who killed her. Like,
the mom? No way.
No. The Casey.
I would. No, he couldn't have been.
Oh, no, because that's right, because he said that they were with Tatum, yeah. It would have made sense, though, considering they do say that
he had dated a motive.
Yeah, so it would have made sense. But, yeah, it's kind of gross, that whole situation. He doesn't take the fact that Casey is somebody he dated is dead.
Yeah.
Grotesquely dead, too.
He jokes about it.
Very seriously. Yeah. Maybe you never know. Maybe he told Billy to do it. It's just like they picked someone that one of them had a grudge against the start. And like, that's just fucking gross.
It would have almost been nice to have another kill in there that had a value to it, but like if they replaced the principal kill with somebody else.
I straight up forgot that the dad made it out of this movie. I thought he died.
Yeah, I really like the fact that they fucking stole him and just kidnapped him.
Yeah, because it does completely throw the trail right off of them, because the cops take the bait because they clone the cell phone and all that stuff. And even Dewey says, like, could they clone a cell phone? And the chief is just like, doesn't even respond.
Yeah.
Just like, he's like, nope, this is our guy. It's like anything else. It's like the cops are like, oh, we found a guy. We can pin this on someone. We can end this shit.
Well, I think the sheriff says, like, it's possible, but this is the only lead we have right now.
Yeah, he just doesn't seem very,
he doesn't believe that's the case.
Yeah, like, dismissive isn't maybe not the correct term, but, like, he doesn't feel like there's any weight to that. Like, is somebody really going to go through an effort to clone someone's cell phone? Well,
yeah.
The answer is yes, they will. Also, their plan kind of sucks because they're going to put the they're not thinking about this because they think it's a movie, but they're going to put the phone and the voice changer in his pocket without gloves. so their fingerprints.
Well, the biggest thing to me was the gloves, because yeah, like
where are the gloves?
They've fucking did everything with their fingerprints everywhere. It's like, clearly the gloves are gonna be like, well, it doesn't make a whole lot of sense to make it stylistically look good in the film.
Yeah.
But if it just had gloves, the plan would work a lot better.
But also at the same time, again, like, they're not thinking about these things because they're thinking about it like it's a movie.
Yeah.
And they just think, oh, well, if we do these things, we're just
dumbass
gonna get away with it.
Watching giallo films.
Yeah. But like they just think they're gonna get away with it because they don't understand that what they do in real life. They don't understand that this is real life, and that's just the demented part about them.
I also think that they just don't. They see this shit being an open shut case thing that they're not gonna do fingerprints.
Yeah, like they're
just not gonna even fucking care.
Yeah, there won't even be an investigation. It's like, that's not how that works.
Well, I think it's because of. Maybe they did it similarly with the mom or whatever. They're like, got away with that shit. We'll get with this too.
Yeah, I mean, but they it's kind of airtight what they did. And also, again, like they're counting on the idea that the cops are going to 100% just say, this is it.
Yeah.
And it's just like, that's just not how it's going to happen. Like, they had, because they didn't just have, oh, we put this evidence in Cotton's car. Because Sydney fingered him and said, he's the guy who left my house and killed my mom. So like that's why that worked out. Whereas here they don't have the benefit of that.
The benefit is them being alive.
Yeah, but that's all.
That's all to their conjecture about saying this is what happened.
Yeah. So the problem is that like they're still going to look for evidence because they have to prove that that's the case. That's something that's like, that's very convenient.
Yeah.
That's the thing. It's like, it's so convenient that I think under most circumstances, they're going to double and triple check that shit. And if you're going to plant stuff on people and not wipe your fingerprints off, you're fucked. Like, it's over. Like, they think they thought this plan out. But again, the whole point is that they think that they said movies make killers smarter. It's like, that's really not the case. It makes you dumber. But one thing I wanted to mention was, I think Marco Beltrami's score is so fucking good in this movie.
I think the score is really good. I think some of the needle drop songs take
the
away
soundtrack.
From it. Soundtrack takes away from it sometimes, but I think the score is strong.
I was actually reminded in the theater when they pull up on Stu's house for the party, the Youth of America song.
Yeah.
I forgot that song even existed. And as soon as it started playing, I had a bunch of memories just rush back to me. And I'm like, yes, awesome. It added it to my playlist literally as I walked out of the theater. I fucking love that song. But I didn't notice that very many of the needle drops nearly as much as
Schools
in some
out
other
is the
movies.
The one I noticed the most.
Which one?
School's Out, the Alice Cooper song.
Yeah, that one's a little bit.
They did it in a lot of films. It's not like it's a crazy surprise.
It's not new. It's not new. But that's the only ones I really, the only one I really, really noticed and reacted to was Youth of America. I think that there are movies after this that definitely get really annoying with needle drops.
I think you've always talked to me about that you should probably mention is how you really like Sydney as a final girl.
I think Sydney is actually the best final girl that there's possibly ever been.
I really like her dimension to her character, but I don't know. It all comes down to characters reciting dialogue at the end of the day. I don't like the dialogue she's given in the film a lot of the time. I like the character. I like the dimension. I like the thing she goes through in the film. It's just, if you change some of her lines, I'd like her a whole lot more.
Yeah, I don't have any problem with her dialogue, honestly. But I just think that from a pure, you know, she has an insurmountable task here. You know, most final girls, you know, you get to a situation where, like, you get the virginal final girl who, you know, is quote unquote paying attention because they weren't having sex, even though that's rarely the point. But Sydney, from like the beginning, is on the attack and defensive when someone's coming after her. She is very very capable from the beginning. You know, she's running away, but she's being very defensive in her decisions. She's thinking on her feet. And I think that she has more dimension as a character than most final girls do. Not all. I mean, there's other ones that have pretty solid dimension, but I think that she has some of the best development in most of slasher movies. I also think that her quality of acting is better than, I think, most of slasher final girls.
I can't really argue that. I think the actress does a great job.
I have a particular stable of favorite ones, and she's definitely my number one. You know, like Rachel Carruthers from Halloween 4. I love her. I think she's great. You know, I think that I love Amy Steele in Friday Part 2. You know, Laurie Strode, obviously. I like Laurie Strode. Pick your movie. She's good in most of them except for Halloween 2. Or I should say Jamie Lee Curtis is Laurie Strode.
Yeah.
Definitely specify that. You know, I have stables of ones I really like, but I think that, especially because as a like, I've seen all four movies, and I think that she just gets better and better. Maybe not better and better, because three's not a really good
movie. It's a question I'd have to really think hard about, but I don't think she's the first one that comes to mind as my favorite, but I think she's definitely one of the best. I think as far as acting caliber for a final girl, though, Neve Campbell does a fantastic job, and she's above, if not all of them, a large majority of them.
Yeah. I just think that, especially her character, the character of Sydney Prescott, you know, she has a lot of baggage. And especially in the finale, it all comes to a head. And especially in a situation like she's in, where she's dealing with not just the fact that she's finding out that not only was she right about Billy, but also Billy killed her mother. He's tormenting her about this, the revelation that her mother was actually having affairs with people. These are all very soul-crushing things that could honestly just make someone just lay down. But she wins. She fights relentlessly. And I think that that's really strong. Because like a lot of slasher movies, you know, like I love watching slasher movies. We both like watching slasher movies, but rarely, I think, do most characters get as much dimension as I would say Sydney Prescott does. It's kind of unfair. Especially because this movie has, generally speaking, a half hour at least over most slasher movies to give more character work and dynamics to people.
I can't really agree, because I feel like the film's not over. It's not even 2 hours long.
It's 1:50. I'm estimating.
But also, she's not in the film for like 10 minutes.
Yeah, but at the same time, though, she is getting consistent. Like, her storyline is progressed through the entire thing, and you're learning more about her as the movie's going on.
Yeah, I'm just saying, like, there's no reason other films can't do as good of a job, is what I'm saying.
Yeah, I'm just saying that the movie has more time to accomplish all of the things it wants to do, including building characters. You know, like, when you have a movie where you're mandated to have a movie that's under 90 minutes, like 85 minutes, it's like,
yeah,
you have to prioritize what you're doing, and most of the time, that goes to kills.
I would say a lot of slasher films do have about an hour and a half, though, and if...
Yeah, most of them
like you said, if they're prioritizing killing over your character development, like, it is what it is. Not a lot of characters have films that, like, focuses on the people rather than the killers, like someone like Stepfather, you know?
Yeah, that's
character based.
That's the whole thing with Scream, though. It's like, this is an 1:50 long movie. There's, in comparison, yeah, like in comparison, yeah, in comparison to other slasher movies, they don't focus nearly as much on kills.
Yeah,
a lot of it's more so like tormenting Sydney.
Yeah,
and I think that because of that, they do spend more time letting you get to know the character. And like automatically setting her up having this interconnected trauma within the town that is not just her issue, not just her baggage, but it was the talk of a small town that people are still talking about a year later, that has been brought back up from the depths after another person is murdered. You know, we're living with her as she's, you know, haunted by this past. And I think that that's something that we don't get nearly as much, I think. Especially in, like, movies that would come after this, too. Like, 90s slasher movies. you know, you don't, I don't think you really get to know people nearly as much as you do in this movie.
Yeah, I mean, there's films like Hollow Man where they do a pretty decent job of giving the characters dimension.
I was about to say, I more so meant slasher movies, but Hollow Man's kind of
a slasher film.
Kind of a slasher movie, so, yeah. But I just think that, again, like, you compare this to something like, I mean, you just watched The Mutilator, like, it's not even comparable.
That's like 89.
Yeah, it's not, I'm more so saying slasher movies in general now, but, like,
yeah,
you know, it's not even comparable. Like, the attention to the character in The Mutilator versus Scream is just, like...
Yeah, I mean, those...
Non-existent.
Most slashers that have low budgets done by, like, fucking random people just trying to make films... You know, they're not good movies, but they're just people making shit at the end of the day. Is it very good? No. Is it enjoyable to see a film set in a certain decade you can't do again? Yeah.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it's not even comparable to the amount of success or just creativity in Scream.
Yeah, I mean, like, we've talked about this before. Like, I don't generally need to have, like, super-duper deep characters in slasher movies.
You need a likability at the very least.
Yeah, likable characters is good enough for me at that point. As long as I enjoy watching these people. I would say it feels at least like we take more time than usually. But maybe that's just because we get more of it in bursts.
I mean, they do a good job between giving characters screen time. I mean, I feel like Randy is not nearly in as much as I remembered him being in it.
Yeah, I mean, it's because when everyone thinks about Scream, the first thing they think about is the rules scene.
Yeah.
And it's like, he's kind of just there sometimes. It's Tatum one of the
is a much better friend and character than I remember. She's actually very good.
Yeah.
She's very likable. Her death is the only death, really, that has impact in the movie.
She's very protective of Sydney, especially when the media comes after her.
Yeah. I like Dewey more this watch. I liked Courtney Cox's character less.
Yeah, you're not supposed to think of her much.
Yeah, you're not supposed to, but I just find her portrayal to be annoying. She's supposed to be annoying. Yeah. I get it.
She gets better.
Yeah.
I know you haven't seen 2, 3, or 4, but she definitely is a character that improves.
I guess, final thoughts then?
I fucking love this movie. And all seeing this, I'm the exact reverse of you. Seeing this in the theater last night only reinforced how much I love it.
I don't think you're the exact opposite of me on that. I think I feel the exact same way.
What?
It reinforced exactly what I thought about the film.
Well, I'm saying that it reinforced for you the things you don't. Well, I guess.
No, it reinforced the things I like too. Yeah.
Yeah. But I know that it reminded me how much of this movie I like. And even, you know, obviously now that we've been doing this podcast and the past couple of years we've been watching a horror movie a day or you know, talking about horror movies constantly. Since, you know, the first time I saw this movie to now, I pick up on a lot more of the shit they're talking about. Like, I didn't know what the fuck the Town That Dreaded Sundown was back when I first saw this movie. I had no idea that was a movie. But, you know, it is kind of... I do find the Easter egg hunt... It's not really an Easter egg hunt. They do shove it in your face.
Yeah.
But I do find a lot of the references to be cheeky. I do like the fact that they do use a lot of this whole, like, meta... idea in my opinion as a smoke and mirrors to the real point, which is everyone has been throwing this vitriol at horror movies for so long about how they're all the same movie and how they all follow the same formula, and what are we going to do? We're going to completely throw that out of whack. And I think that's why it all works for me, is because it is kind of counter to what I think most people think the movie really is. And again, you know, I think that Sydney is possibly the best final girl of all time. The acting's all really good. The score's fantastic. I think the dialogue's mostly snappy. There's some shit that's a little bit annoying. I think the movie's perfectly paced. I think this is definitely one of the strongest horror movies in the 90s, for sure. And I absolutely adore this movie. So
I definitely say it's one of the strongest films in the 90s for horror.
Yeah, but you don't like 90s horror.
Doesn't change the point.
Like this, it's like this and Nightbreed.
Yeah, Nightbreed's way better.
Yeah, and I know how much you like Nightbreed more.
Yeah, I think
not that I don't adore Nightbreed. I love them.
I still think that it's a well-crafted film. I like a lot of the components of it. I would change a lot of the dialogue. A lot of it's insufferable. So just everything coming down to it being like a movie is part of the plot. but it's just too in your face about it. Sometimes it comes off to reflecting about, yes, maybe this is how people see horror films and they think they know everything, but this doesn't. But at the same time, I think that weighs into saying, a lot of the time this is horror films, but this one is different, and that's why this one is better. And I feel like the movie leans itself too much into that direction, where I feel like it's almost praising itself more than praising the genre. And it takes away for me personally. I would never say someone should enjoy this movie. I think people should watch it, make up their own mind, because it's a lot of fun. And,
yeah,
you know, I feel the same way when you left the theater saying it reinforced exactly what I thought about the film. It heightened all the things that I liked about it. All the good shit in this movie is not just good, it's really fucking good. But all the things I don't like are not just bad. To me, they're really fucking annoying. So, I left the theater feeling the same, but stronger about my feelings on this film. Which you should after seeing a film in theater. You should have a strong opinion on these films. Yeah. Or any film you see, really. So
it's a different experience.
Yeah, 100%. And I'm really glad I saw it in theaters. It was a great experience. And I wish people would go out to see more films like this in theaters, have that experience, make up their own mind. You know, I don't love a lot of this shit, but the things that are good are ridiculously good. And it changed horror in the 90s, for better or for worse. It is what it is. And if this wasn't going to do it, some other film would have done it. And it probably would have been a worse film. So I'm glad this film did it.
It's interesting, too, because we both...
Actually, I know another film would have done it. I Know What You Did Last Summer did it, and they did it worse.
Well, that movie wouldn't exist without this movie.
Yeah, but I'm sure...
It's written by the same man.
Yeah.
I actually think it's kind of funny, because, you know, we're talking about the meta commentary in this movie and how much we do or don't like it. And this isn't Wes Craven's first time around on the old meta commentary bandwagon.
No, because
New Nightmare is fucking awesome.
I love New Nightmare.
I fucking love New Nightmare. So it's like, this is not his first attempt, but this one significantly more higher profile. I think that this one's easier for people to go and watch than, I think New Nightmare's a little bit more,
it's more convoluted.
It's one of those movies where, like, this movie is very much heightened by how much fun you're trying to have with it, whereas New Nightmare is not particularly fun.
No.
Not nearly as fun, at least. So
I don't think the
easier...
metatextual stuff is nearly as important in New Nightmare.
Because it's less about horror movies and more about literally, specifically, the franchise of Nightmare on Elm Street.
Yeah.
And Hollywood for these people.
Yes.
So it's very specific to that. But it is just kind of fun that he's done this. He did this before, it didn't work, and then he did it again, because this movie's a lot more slick and aimed at teenagers.
Yeah.
We're not going to see this aimed at slashers. Yeah, like
it's
we're not
aimed
here
for
to
that demographic.
Yeah, like we're not here to really think about it so much.
Yeah, when this film came out, it was not long after shit like Jason Goes to Hell and shit.
Yeah, 93 was Jason Goes to Hell. This is 96. And Freddy's Dead. And then New Nightmare came out in the 90s.
I think New Nightmare was 93, wasn't it? Or 94.
94. Right? 94. Yeah. It was not that far. It's probably right before he prepped this, honestly. So it's kind of funny. He did these pretty much back to back. And one of them not successful, one of them extremely successful.
So final score? Cool.
9.5 out of 10.
Yeah.
7.5. I love this movie so much. I'm happy. I don't get to see very many classic movies in theaters. You know, we tried to go see Dracula.
I would have seen one every week this year or this month. I would have seen one a week.
Yeah,
and I've seen only one.
Yeah, because
we got fucked twice.
We were going to see Dracula and Frankenstein back to back in theaters, but the projection was fucked. So we didn't get to see that. And then we were going to go see Evil Dead.
That was my own fault. I had other plans that were more important, and I didn't realize I double booked. So
yeah, I couldn't go because I was sick. I didn't feel good. I didn't feel like I could really go see the movie. So I missed that. I'm really sad I missed that, because that would have been really fun in the theater. I wish that every fucking day they had a class. Somebody would throw classic horror movies in theaters, or classic movies in general, that you could just go and watch them in theaters, because it really does. You know, everyone talks about the theatrical experience and how it changes things for you. And they're like, ah, it's not that important. It really is. It really does change it. I think it really can put you in a very different mind space when you're going to see a movie. And I think it can either improve a movie, or it can at least reinforce the things that you enjoy about the movie or dislike about the movie. But I feel like it's kind of hard for your attention to wane, at least for me, at least, because there's plenty of people who are on their phones in the theater. But I feel like it's very difficult to lose attention to a movie that is literally completely across your entire vision space. The darkness, the sound surrounding you, I feel like it's kind of hard to not be transfixed. And for Scream, I think that maybe that improved the movie exponentially for me, even more than I already loved it. And I would love to see what other movies would look like on a big screen that I never got to see, because either they came out before I was born or I missed them.
Yeah, I feel the same way. I'm sure next year we'll have more. I feel like the only good thing about the pandemic is it's put more movies coming out nowadays than ever for bringing back films.
Yeah, because you brought me to see King Kong. That was my first time seeing King Kong ever. I saw it in the theater.
King Kong, I've seen quite a lot in theaters for older films now.
Yeah, because you've hiked up Salem and stuff like that. That was my first time seeing Night of the Living Dead. That was another really fun movie to watch.
I've seen Creature. I've seen Bride of Frankenstein in a church. Nice. What else have I seen? I've seen House. I would have liked to see Alice this month, but I'm not going to be able to see that.
I'm really mad that
I really love that movie.
I'm really mad that a couple years back I wasn't able to get up to Salem to see Suspiria on a big screen. I feel like that would just be magic, pure magic.
Yeah. Salem does a lot, though, this year. They've already done, like, a new specialty film every week.
Yeah, just like going to Salem in October is a nightmare.
Well, that's why I'm not going to see Alice Sweet Out. I would love to. I was going to see a film in theaters right now, I'd love to see that one. That'd be fucking amazing. But
having to fight through that traffic, I can't. No matter what movie they're playing, I can't do it. It's too much. Everyone goes to Salem in October, and it's just an absolute nightmare to go around.
Yeah, it's not worth it.
I just wish local theaters would do this shit, man. Like, I don't want to have to, like, I don't want to have to wait for anniversaries for movies to see these things. Like, these are things that you should continuously keep in public consciousness, reminding people these movies exist. They're classics for a reason. People should have immediate theatrical access to them, because it does really change things for people.
People should just go see films more often. You know, we talk about wanting it to happen more, but the problem is that nobody else cares. Like, when we saw Dracula, nobody else was there.
Yeah, we were the only two people in the theater. Actually, when we were leaving, there were people who were going to see it. I heard them talking. So there were going to be more people. They were going to be late, but there was going to be more people. But they saw us getting our refunds, and they're like, oh. Yeah. So, yeah.
Well, next film we're going to cover is Saw. We'll have a decent time talking about that. Oh, we had a good time. We had a great time.
Yeah, we had to re-record it, but it was actually kind of like a godsend that we had to re-record it, because the second time around was...
It was really good. I mean, the first time was good too, but I think the next episode is genuinely going to be a really fun one.
Yeah.
And then our last episode is also going to be a good talking about... I just might watch the film again, because it's already been...
I'm going to rewatch it, yeah.
I don't even need to, dude. I can have a fucking audio on, because I've heard everything.
I watch that movie at least 4 times a year. I don't need to rewatch it, but I'm gonna.
Thank you.
I'm gonna watch it with a commentary. I've never watched it with a commentary. The first time I ever watched a movie with a commentary was when we did Friday Part 4. Ever.
Really?
Yeah, it's the first time I ever heard a commentary.
I've watched a lot of films with commentaries.
Well, I always say to myself, I'm like, oh, if I'm going to watch a movie, I should just watch a fucking movie.
We can't do this. So, I got to edit this shit. We got to get this shit done. All right, we'll talk about that shit later, man. So, thanks a lot for joining us for Scream. I hope you have a good time. I hope you watch the film. You know, besides my thoughts on it that are very skewed because of the films I enjoy and the things I've partaken in, like Mike said, there's a lot of people that can go into this film, have a really good time. You know, not have this shit be tough to digest, but just really kick back, have popcorn, and enjoy it. And I hope you have that experience. I hope you have a great time. You watch this film, you listen to this episode, and say, you know what? I'm gonna go over. I'm gonna watch these killers, have a good time, and then just fucking you know, also kill your virgin girlfriend. All right, catch you later. Bye bye.